Simon & Schuster Audio presents God's Guest List, Welcoming Those Who Influence Our Lives by Debbie Macomber. Read by Beth DeVries.
To my family, my husband Wayne and children, Jody, Jenny, Ted, and Dale, how very blessed I am to have you in my life. Therefore, I am sending you prophets and wise men and teachers. Matthew chapter 23, verse 34. 1. Presents, people, and one more list. An unfinished guest list. There's a story that goes something like this. A woman arrived at the gates of heaven to be met by Saint Peter. "You may first want to join the others at the throne," he said to her, "and then greet those you loved on earth. But when you are ready, I'll take you on a tour of heaven." When the time came for her tour, she could hardly take it all in. It reminded her a little of her earthly home, but she could see that earth had only been a pale shadow of what she was seeing now. They explored every nook and cranny of heaven. Waterfalls, fields of flowers, exquisite buildings, and streets of gold. As the tour drew to an end, she noticed one massive door they had not yet explored. A gold padlock secured it. "What's in that room?" she asked. "You don't want to see that room," St. Peter said, steering her away from it. "It's only a storeroom." "But I do. May I see inside? I want to see every bit of heaven." St. Peter didn't answer. Instead, he took a large key out of his pocket, put it in the lock, and turned it. The tumblers clicked, and the padlock opened. He took the lock off and opened the door. The woman had to blink several times to take it all in. Inside the cavernous room were stacks and stacks of gifts, wrapped in all the colors of the rainbow and tied with all the colors of heaven. She clapped her hands with delight. "Is this where you store presents for everyone in heaven?" "No, these gifts are not for heaven. They were meant for earth." "What do you mean, were?" She walked through the stacks and came to a pile marked with her name. "Look, these gifts are for me." She fingered the paper and ribbons. "May I open them?"
"No, you don't need them now."
St. Peter put a hand on her shoulder, guiding her toward the door. "But if I don't need them now, does that mean I needed them on earth?" She couldn't take her eyes off the pile. To think she would never get to enjoy all those beautifully wrapped gifts. He nodded his head. "Yes, you needed them on earth." She looked around the room, realizing that there must have been millions of gifts. Maybe more, since she couldn't see an end to the room. "Why weren't my gifts sent to me on earth?" As she looked closer, she could read names on all the gifts. "Not just my gifts. Why haven't any of these gifts been sent?" St. Peter sighed. "You don't understand. Every one of them was sent." Moving his arm in an arc that encompassed the whole room, he said, "All of these and more. These are the ones that were returned unopened." He moved her toward the door. "Many people on earth don't recognize God's gifts and fail to open them." I love gifts, both giving and receiving. When I first heard this story, I wondered if there was any truth to the parable. Had God sent gifts to me that I hadn't opened? When I get to heaven, I don't want to discover that I failed to recognize the gifts God sent into my life. I don't want to miss a single one. Unfortunately, in real life, God's presents don't always come gaily gift-wrapped, and they are not always easily recognized. Some, even initially, come looking like challenges, and often these gifts are people-shaped. The Second List. If you've read any one of my nonfiction books, you know I'm a list maker. Goals, objectives, tasks, they all go on lists. Socrates said, "The unexamined life is not worth living."
I've taken his advice to heart and take a careful look at my life day by day in order to make the most of my time and efforts. Many years ago, I read The Aladdin Factor by Jack Canfield, who co-authored the Chicken Soup series. This was before the series was as well known as it is now. The one thing I remember most about that book was something Jack Canfield wrote. He made a list of 30 people he wanted to meet in his life. Entertainers, authors, musicians, people whose work he deeply admired and whom he wanted to thank. What an idea! It inspired me and I set about making a list of my own, 30 people I wanted to meet. I started out with Pat Conroy, one of the most gifted writers of our time. The list was filled with people I'd admired throughout my life, writers, musicians, speakers, and others. At the time, the possibility of meeting those on my list seemed impossible. But one by one, God brought them into my life, and I gratefully checked them off my list one by one. A few years ago, I attended a writers' conference. An author from my list whom I'd long admired was to be the keynote speaker. I wanted to tell him the story of how I came to find him and how his writing had inspired me, so it was arranged for us to meet and talk. We sat in a quiet corner of the hotel lobby, and I began to tell him what his work has meant to me. Halfway through the story, he stopped me. "Just a minute. You have to stop, because I need to bask." That's B-A-S-K. Bask. I didn't know what he meant until he closed his eyes and began to breathe deeply through his nose. He waved his hands as if to fan my words toward him and got a weird look on his face as he appeared to soak in my words of encouragement. It was all I could do to keep from bursting out laughing. That someone would need to bask in the glory of a simple compliment flabbergasted me. Long after that conference was over, I continued to think about that incident. It was so odd. The more I thought about it, the more disappointed I became in this person. I had held him in such high regard. How could I have been so wrong? Instead of reflecting any glory back to God, this author chose to absorb it for himself, to bask in my praise. The sad thing is that he wasn't the only one from my list who turned out to be a disappointment. I had listed a well-known, much-loved singer with a career history that spans 40 years. The lyrics he sings are so beautiful and touch me deeply, but I came to find out they're lyrics written by other people. It soon became obvious that he was so plastic, so saccharine, that if I had met him in any other circumstance, I confess I would have automatically avoided him. His world revolved around him. Because people had kowtowed to him for so long, he had no patience. His frustration threshold was dangerously low. I watched as he snapped his fingers at people, signaling them to bring him things. It was cringeworthy. Even more telling, his annoyance and rudeness turned to smiles the moment someone lifted a camera in his direction. Sad. During my morning prayer time, shortly after my visit with the author at the writers' conference, I found myself telling God how disillusioned I was with so many of the people on my list. It didn't take too many disappointments to conclude that unless the person stayed God-centered, fame and talent seemed to ruin the person in some way. Basking in their own accomplishments led to self-absorption and self-obsession. Many of them didn't even seem to see other people. So that morning I complained to God how disappointed I was in several of the people on my list. Then it hit me. My disappointment stemmed not from the fact that these people were flawed. We are all flawed. The true source of my disappointment was that I had misplaced my admiration. As I prayed, I sensed that God was saying, "There is a reason I had that happen, Debbie. It's because I want you to make another list. You asked me to send those 30 people into your life. You're my daughter. I love you, and as your father, I want to give you the things that you ask for, but I also wanted you to see people."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.